Next up is Rob. The road to great customer experiences is always paved with good intentions. The landscape around us is changing, and most companies find themselves in some kind of transformational state. The best tool for navigating in such a turbulent conditions? Design. Driving down this road, many organizations have realized that they have a blind spot, a very critical blind spot, and that is design implementation. And the steering wheel feels greasy, design efforts are unaligned, uncontrolled, and messing up the entire customer experience. Rob here is principal consultant at Informat Experience Design, and he's here to tell us about what he believes is the vehicle of the future, the experience transformation. Give him a warm round of applause.
Wow, thank you. What an introduction. Hello, everybody. Just like all of you, I'm fascinated by the enterprise. I've been working as a designer for about 20 years now in many different enterprises. And as all designers will tell you, there's always a point where you can't sort of improve the experience by just designing harder. There's all sorts of stuff that you run into, like how open is the organization for design, how are the processes and the budgets for design being organized. And after having been frustrated about that, at some point I decided, okay, I should do something about that. And in my talk, I would like to share you some experiences and ideas about doing this. First, a bit of context or explaining you sort of my perspective. So I graduated about 25 years ago at Utrecht College of Art as probably one of the first interaction designers, as it was called. And the first part of my professional life, I was doing this sort of stuff. So designing the interaction for products and services. In this case, a Nokia media player. And the thing what you try to do is you describe the different stages of the interface and the interaction of the user between those stages. And the aim what you try to do is you make it logical, efficient, easy to use, and easy to understand. And I've sort of been lucky to be able to do this in organizations that already had some maturity with design because they had product design already in place. And product designers have gone to the same sort of experiences as we now have with digital design, only then 30 years earlier. At the second part of my professional life, I started doing this sort of stuff. So designing the organization, and this is an example of a design organization of a health insurance company. And for me, it sort of still feels the same. I'm sort of describing the different stages of the design in the enterprise, the interaction between them, and it should be sort of logical and efficient. So you could say that my personal ambitious endeavor has been the transition from wireframing applications to designing organizations. I work for a company called Informat. We are 80 experienced designers, all with a passion of designing excellent experiences. And the thing that makes us different from typical design agencies is that we also want to support our clients in becoming better in design themselves. And that's my current role as a consultant. I work with management to introduce design in the enterprise. There's two terms I'll be using a lot in my talk, so I better give a definition of them. The first one is customer experience. So this definition, I think it's really good. The customer experience is sort of the sum of all interactions of a customer with your organization. It's holistic, it's dynamic, it's about emotions, and the memory of the experience is important as well. And then the second thing is experience design. So that's the discipline of designing products, services, and processes with the aim of making the experience as good as possible. And this is not a new thing, so I see it sort of as a logical development of the field of human-centered design. As sort of experience design is sort of the latest scope in that perspective. But what's also interesting, at some point designers started looking at stuff that we needed to do our work better, whether it's tools or design processes or managing design teams and projects. And to me, enterprise design is again a logical step in that perspective. So why should enterprises bother about experience design? Well, there's lots of research from the usual suspects like Forrester and Gartner and Temkin Group. But there's four things that sort of stand out from that research. I think on C-level management, this is becoming an issue. They see customer experience as a way of sort of meeting their objectives. Experience design is also considered as strategic, so it gives you a competitive advantage for the future. Customers who perceive a good experience, sort of they spend more money and time on your services. And finally, it has a risk of not doing it as well. So the story that we tell to our clients is, if you really want this excellent customer experience, you need to aim for customer experience excellence in your organization, sort of as a counterbalance to operational excellence. And by this, we mean that you need to start orchestrating all the activities in your enterprise that have an impact on the customer experience. Logically, the first place to start will be on the outside ring, so the stuff that you're hopefully already doing for your customer, like branding, marketing, communication, and your products and services. But there's also a lot of stuff inside the organization that you're not necessarily doing visibly for the customer. My experience is that enterprises sort of develop their maturity in this way. So it always starts with the outward experience. So if you start from a low maturity, just start designing your first app and your website until you reach a point that you need tools or processes, and then you move up, etc. So there's two axes, one focusing on the outward, the customer, and the other one focusing on the inside. Just to give you a bit of context where the rest of my story is based upon, we mostly work for Dutch enterprises. They're sort of internationally seen as medium or large sized. They include financial institutes, government, and a bit of specialized IT companies. And what they all have in common is that they're in these transformations. And by transformation, I mean a sort of orchestrated change. So I don't think you can be in a digital transformation if you sort of don't orchestrate this. Again, the first digital transformation already going on for some decades and probably will last in the future. The second one, the agile transformation, starting a few years ago with small agile projects. Then delivery started working agile, and sort of the last step is business agility there as well. And the final one, most enterprises don't know yet that they're already in this or that there should be the experience transformation. And these transformations have a massive impact on the organization. So they result in many reorganizations, in people losing their jobs. But at the same time, they sort of create opportunities for design. And in the remainder of my talk, I would like to show you for each of these transformations some opportunities for design. So let's start with the digital transformation, like the caterpillar eating up all physical matter. Digital transformation is a really big, overly used term, but I think for enterprises it means that they need to do three things. One is digitizing their analog services. The second one is sort of improving their existing digital services. And the third one is sort of coming up with new services that physically were not even possible yet. And this picture sort of shows also how it changed the relationship of the enterprise with the customer. So a couple of years ago, most of the relationship with the customers was with physical touch points, an office, an employee, a mail, etc., or a telephone. At the enterprise today, sort of many of those touch points are digital. And this changed a lot of stuff. First of all, a demand in digital design. So that was good for us. Also, it meant that customers needed to do more stuff themselves. So self-service became a really big thing. And for this, usability, again, is quite important. So if you look at a bank today, this is the Dutch bank ING, they have quite an advanced digital ecosystem. They have multiple apps and websites for either daily banking, personal finance, etc. And this is what it looks on the outside. But I would like to show you what happened on the inside of the enterprise as well. So in the early stages of the digital transformation, this probably started with a new customer need, like a website. Typically, the enterprise would respond by defining a project team, either an external agency or an internal project, that would do concept design, detailed design, and then implement it. If sometime later there would be an additional customer need, the enterprise would again respond by setting up a new project. And these projects were generally not sort of not aligned, or they were even in different parts of the enterprise. So the result was the customer would notice this because it was an inconsistent experience. And if you're professional, you don't want the experience to be inconsistent. So then this was the point that enterprises started hiring their design leads or design managers. And at least in the Netherlands, this was sort of 10 years ago when this became a thing. And the design manager, one of the main tasks was to sort of align these processes by sort of using principles and guidelines. But again, the projects increased at this stage. Sort of there were maybe 10 digital projects already running in the enterprise. So the design manager said, hey, this is really inefficient. I need to check all this stuff, and they need to redesign, and it doesn't really work very well. So the technical part of design became a bit more advanced. So some of the stuff that all the digital projects had in common, they were taken out of the individual projects and were sort of done up front. Things like the digital identity or accessibility principles, they were done up front. And then translated into a design system, which is sort of a single source of truth of the experience. Result of this was that projects needed to do less concepting work. So if you needed a funnel to sell a new product, you could just grab this from the library and reuse this. Most of the design systems and design architectures that I know of, they're sort of reversed engineered based on the existing services. So soon there was a demand for like a more strategic form of design. For example, what do we really mean by mobile first, or are we omni-channel or cross-channel? And then sort of the latest stage of design is strategic, looking at the whole service ecosystem and the journeys. This, of course, is an enterprise that is already quite mature, but I think for many enterprises, this will sort of move in the same way. So if you look at the enterprise as a whole, there's already quite a lot of design activities going on. And there's also a lot of designers in the enterprise. Not just digital designers, but also brand designers and marketing designers. And this looks like a nice overview, but those designers might not even be collaborating or aware that they're in the same enterprise, but I will be talking about it a bit later. So to summarize how internal design teams sort of emerged in the digital transformation. They moved in scope from operational to strategic. They came from completely external to sort of a hybrid. And the last thing, I haven't talked about that that much, but the process also changed as well. So traditionally it was the design agency that brought in the design process. Then the design manager sort of had a say on the process. But the later stage is that Agile overruled the design process. And that brings me to the next transformation. The cocoon, or poopoo, I think it's called. With lots of expectations what this transformation will bring, but nobody really knows what will come out of it. When I first heard about Agile, I was actually quite excited. It was about multidisciplinary, delivering stuff really quickly, just doing the design, not the documentation. So I thought, hey, this works really well with how we work as designers. But where it sort of went wrong is when enterprises started adopting scaled agile frameworks, so and agile on an enterprise level. And that's what this opportunity for design was. So whenever I do an assignment in an enterprise and agile is sort of causing a problem for design, the first thing I do is try to map how are they actually working. And this is sort of a typical picture you get if you interview people in an agile team. So the product owner is in the center of the universe. He has a vision of what the company wants to do, what he wants to do with the product, and he has an idea of what users want, or he thinks he has an idea. And he might sort of discuss with management and business stakeholders to come up with this product backlog. And then there's a delivery team who delivers the stuff. But there's a really important thing missing here, and that's, of course, the customer. The interesting thing is, a few years ago, I took, just out of curiosity, product owner training myself, and actually you learn a slightly different agile way of working. So there's this whole part of customer value mapping, which is often forgotten in the enterprise. And actually what you do there is on a regular basis, you sort of talk to real users on the same level as your stakeholders and involve them sort of in coming up with stories and together sort of prioritizing them. And there's tools for this like story mapping and opportunity canvases. And this already is a far accurate picture of what customers want you to start delivering. But again, if you take the enterprise perspective, it looks slightly different. So the agile teams are not sort of self-directing or self-organizing as they think they are, because there's many of them. And in the enterprises I work for, it sort of ranges from 30 to 50 agile teams, and that's for a bank or financial institution. So they have all sorts of dependencies within the organization to deliver input or resources. And this is a simplified sketch. So there's input from management, there's generally product owner, product management committee, there's a design team that delivers stuff. Often the agile teams are not able to release stuff, so there's a release or backend team. In an international enterprise, there's a massive amount of business stakeholders, and then finally there's sort of the users who might get the value that they want. And there's all sorts of stuff wrong with this approach. So designers are not really involved in that very much. There's no users involved, and there's little time to create really customer value, so a lot of time goes on sort of technical legacy, stuff like that. And finally, it leads, if the teams are really sort of self-organizing, it leads to inconsistency in the experience. But hang on a minute, this is something we just solved with the professional design organization in the digital transformation. So where did it go wrong? Well, I think if you ask designers sort of what would be your ideal process to solve a challenge, they would probably use something like this. It's the double diamond process by the Design Council, and it's already been around for some time, and it's sort of considered as the standard in design processes. And it means that it's an autonomous design process. So it means if you give designers a challenge at enough time, they will sort of diverge and converge and come up with a good solution. But the thing with this is only the last part is about delivering this solution. And agile is all about that last part. And designers who are asked to work in agile, they get asked, like, do all this stuff before, do that in parallel with the agile way of working. And that doesn't work, so that causes all sorts of problems. And the typical response has been to start mapping these processes. So this is an example of the first part of the double diamond process mapped with a lean startup process and then the agile process. But hang on, we're working sort of enterprise scale agile, so frameworks like this. So where do you stop mapping? I'm not sure if you know this last picture, but the guy who made this probably now lives in a monastery. So it's a map of all the processes that are being used in the enterprise. So I thought, well, this is a dead end. So if there's problems with design and agile, I need a different approach. And what I did is sort of hack the existing framework. So the enterprise has chosen an agile framework, and I've included a number of essential design activities or tools that you would need to improve the experience. So a couple of examples. Sorry, Robert, I'm not sure if he's still there with his talk yesterday. I've added a user experience profile to the agile framework. I will explain later why. Introducing qualitative user research methods ranging from a usability lab or guerrilla testing or online forum. A design system. So I think you should not work agile on an enterprise scale if you don't make the design system mandatory. So it should have ownership. It should have input from all the different departments that are responsible for the experience. And it should be part of the definition of done that you're actually using this. And finally, some tools to sort of get quantitative data on the experience. For example, a product owner dashboard that gives the targets and the input from different studies on the experience, or a journey perspective. So you could actually prioritize your different projects based on how important they are in the journey. So the profile I would like to explain, because it was mentioned yesterday specifically. So whenever I run into this agile framework, designers are treated as developers, and they're not. Designers are sort of partly developer and partly architect, because they need to do both the overlying concept and the actual implementation. But also many enterprises, design are sort of a scarce good. There's generally more agile projects doing experience stuff than that there are designers. So this causes a huge problem with experience design. They're just running from agile team to agile team, just being stuck in the minimal meetings and not being able to do the design properly. So you need to have agreements on that as well. So how many projects can a designer handle? Or even sort of include a rule that whenever you have a customer facing agile project, you need to add an extra designer to the team. The thing I've experienced, like I don't get these assignments from the board like, hey, do this agile transformation. There's other people that do get this opportunity. But you can hack this system. So whenever there's an agile transformation team in place, often an external consultant, an agile coach and scrum masters, they meet every week. And this is a good way of collecting design impediments. So quite quickly you have a cluster of stuff that is wrong with the experience or with design. But it's also a nice way to inject these hacks that I've showed earlier. And therefore making the framework designer friendly and customer centric. So then the final transformation. And this is where the butterfly gets to show its real colors. What I noticed looking at different enterprises, if you look at their strategies, it's all about digital and agile. And they don't realize that if they just focus on this alone, all banks, all insurances, you name it, they will soon be digital and agile. So what does make you stand out from the rest? And that's what this transformation should be about, sort of delivering this unique experience that only you can deliver. Just to show a bit sort of the balls that you need to juggle in this transformation, and this metaphor has been used quite often. So let's say you're in the burger business. What is your unique burger compared to all the other companies that are in the burger business? And this is traditionally the domain of brand positioning, brand experience, marketing and communication. Then there's the actual burger that your customer gets, puts in his mouth. This is sort of generally the domain of development, product design, product management. And the gap should not be too big, because otherwise sort of you lose your credibility. And that's probably the reason why this example is used a lot, because in the burger business this can be quite big. I don't know why they can get away with this. And the final bit is sort of staying in touch with what your customers actually want, their changing behaviors or changing needs. So maybe they don't want a burger anymore, they want a healthy option that is not picked up in the restaurant but delivered to you. And this is traditionally the domain of market research, customer analytics, etc. And in the experience transformation, I think one of the first challenges is to get this in sync, because this in many enterprises is not. I think you should not start with the experience transformation, so you better have your designers and design teams in place and hack your process so it works for design and your customers as well. So there's some point where you sort of need to start doing this stuff, look internally, so then you can make the next step externally. And there's two things sort of that I think you should start doing at this stage. The first one is adopt an experience-driven organization model. And the second one is streamlining the last silos that are sort of stopping you from delivering these really good experiences. So let's start with the first one. And I would like to do that at a really simple example, sort of if you would start an enterprise from scratch. So probably have something of value, like a lemonade, and you think, well, people should taste this as well. So you put a stand in your front garden and you start selling the lemonade to people passing by. And it's going well. Your neighbor who bakes good cookies asks, like, can you sell the cookies as well? You think, well, why not? So now you have two products on your stand, which gives you the opportunity to start thinking of new propositions. For example, a package deal if you buy both of them. At some point, you've reached all the people in your street, so you want to expand. You add a new distribution channel. Your brother has a bicycle, so he can deliver some stuff. You're now a multi-channel enterprise, which gives you the need or the opportunity to start thinking of your identity. How would customers know that the bicycle and the stand belong to the same company? So you introduce a t-shirt or a cap with your name on there. Again, your business is going well. There's other people copying your formula. They're copying your lemonade and cookie business. So you need to think of something that makes you unique. So you come up with this positioning like, we're here to make you smile. And this is something you want customers to feel in all the stuff that you're doing, whether it's your propositions, your products or your channels, or the employees that are serving your customers. Well, this sort of gives me a reference model of the experience-driven organization. And this is a very simplified version of it. But it sort of describes how the entities that need to be in sync sort of relate to one another. And this helps me sort of to find out in the enterprise where it's not working. Strategy is happening in all the places, some value not delivered on the right channels, or even some entities doing their own strategy and delivery. The aim is actually to come up with an organization model for a particular enterprise. And this is one for a financial institution, again, a simple version. But there sort of it was decided to organize the value across the life cycle of a customer. So acquisition, service, and retention. But also to give design the impact to direct the experience across all the channels. A lot more detail behind this, but there's one layer that I want to show you because it sort of answers the typical question that I get, like, where should design be? Should it be in business or in IT or be a different entity? And this layer sort of shows design should be anywhere in the enterprise. And this is just an example of some of the roles. They might differ as well. So once you've introduced this collaboration model, I've called it organization model first, but that sort of scared a bit the typical enterprise. The next thing you need to do is add another layer of detail to it. And that should actually solve the silos, the gaps between the silos. And that I would like to show you now. Again, your lemonade and cookie business, there's probably processes behind all the stuff that you're doing, like baking the cookies, selling the lemonade. You might have sort of a more monthly process where you wash your t-shirts or tune your propositions a bit, and an annual process where you look at your competitor landscape and tune your proposition. And the good thing is in enterprises, at least that's my perspective, these processes are working well. So enterprises have been there for a long time. They've tuned these processes. And the proof that it works is that they make money, they deliver stuff, and they update their strategies regularly. But where it goes wrong is if you want to make big changes, like a digital transformation or an agile transformation, then you need to sort of make sure that changes in your strategy are also noticeable in your delivery. And enterprise architects have an interesting concept for this called the information supply chain. And what I understand from the chain is that it sort of links the different processes or activities, and if there's a change in the chain, it should affect the stuff that it links. I think design should start orchestrating or even owning a number of these chains. I call them experience chains. Why? Because design is really good in thinking of the customer and visualizing the experience. So how would you go about this? I think the first step is sort of based on this concept map, what is there. And I take an easy example, that's the brand experience or the brand identity chain. Good way of doing this is interviewing the people involved. And what you learn is that the chain runs right across the company. So from strategy to branding, in the end to agile teams. And you also discover what sort of the discrete activities or responsibilities are in this chain. And that there's processes behind them that might or might not be in sync. And since these are experience chains, I also start looking at what are the designers that are involved? And are they aware that they actually have a responsibility to one another? Deliverables are also very interesting because they're mostly sort of created in isolation. So I've sort of a hobby of collecting different principles that describe the experience. And it's amazing what you get, sort of the brand principles not matching with the customer experience principles or the user experience principles. And it gets really interesting, and of course this is the case in many enterprises. The chains are often broken. So branding, doing a new positioning, launching within a few months a marketing campaign and a television commercial, and the whole digital interactive channel sort of like, oh, what happened here? We were not prepared for this, because the interactive channels take a lot longer to tune. Or there might be multiple design systems in use, which is of course very inefficient. Well, you get the picture of sort of how to map the chain. So that's a good first step. So map the chain, it's a new concept, so of course there is not really a chain, but the visualization helps you to start discussing with management and designers, is this really how we want it to be organized? And the answer, of course, is often no. It's a pity that we're not working more with UX, not sort of aligning the strategies together. So the next step will be sort of to improve the experience design chain. And now you have made sort of this move up in the maturity. So then again, you can sort of improve the experience that runs through the chain. So last slide about this topic. How many of those experience chains are there? Basically, if I would categorize sort of the stuff that I come across, I see three essential experience design chains. The first one is focusing on the channel experience. So starting from the positioning, what is the experience you actually want to have, all the way sort of to delivering the experience. And it should, of course, be unique, consistent, and efficient. So this one is focusing on your bicycle and stand, making your customers smile. The second category of chains is related to value propositions. How are your products created? And I don't mean your apps and your websites, but for example, your financial products. How can you make them give more value to users? How can you make your financial products more customer-centric and relevant and unique? So this chain focuses on the lemonade and cookies, making your customers smile. And finally, this is a set of chains. I've called them the relationship chains. They work two ways. So first, what is the relationship actually you want to have with your customer based on your unique positioning? But also, how do you respond to customer feedback and changing customer behavior? And customer analytics is sort of playing a big role in this one. And this should actually make sure that you're not just saying you're customer-centric, but that you really are, that customers notice that something is done with their behavior change or feedback. So this is basically the chain that if your customer drops her lemonade in front of your stand, you give her a new one and make her smile. So that's the last slide of my talk. There's basically three things that I would like to leave you with, and probably they're not a surprise. Transformations are a great way of introducing design, strengthening design, even if you're not in the capability of starting this transformation yourself. zoom out on the enterprise and look what design is all there and try to fix this. So I raised my hand when it was asked, like, should we do design thinking in the company or just have more designers? Well, the answer, of course, is clear. Align the designers in the enterprise. And finally, use the essential experience design chains to sort of start orchestrating the credible, unique experience. Thank you very much.